We've the second of tonight's reports from Ray Gosling now on BBC Four, again 5 minutes later than billed, giving a personal view and hearing from those who live and work within Manchester's Trafford Park industrial estate.
There's a couplet by W.H. Auden. Goes something like, oh, how my heart has stamped on that view from Birmingham to Wolverhampton. Slag heaps and machinery, they're my favourite kind of scenery. I've always liked work, what we once had. You could see manufacturing.
Wagon wheels, axles and acid, Kraft fairy liquid and Daz detergent, Lancaster bombers in the war and before Henry Ford cars and Rolls-Royce cranes, Semolina, ICI, the glucose for Mars bars, DDT, penicillin, AEI and the cold meat store. Combustion, carborundum, superheaters, oil and cake, tea and timber, the caramel colouring for oxtail soup, and the starch for the sticky you lick on an envelope.
This bus I'm on is one of hundreds that every working morning cross Greater Manchester to pour into Trafford Park. 60,000 people work in Trafford Park. That's as many workers as the total population of a town like Chester or Eastbourne or Barrow-in-Furness. Trafford Park was the first industrial estate in the world, the mother of what planners today say every town should have, a tract of land specially set aside for industry.
It was the London airport of its Edwardian age, with the biggest private railway system in the land. And it all began when Manchester built the ship canal and the Lord de Trafford's stately home opposite Salford Dock became totally surrounded by filthy canal water. The noble lord didn't want to live opposite all of this, so he sold to a private company of three gentlemen, one of whom was the manager of the ship canal company, Mr. Marshall Stevens.
Two other gentlemen were caught up in the scheme who they don't commemorate. Horatio Bottomley, a politician, and Terence Hooley, who was the financier. Poor Mr. Hooley went to prison.
Mr. Terra Hooley also wanted to turn it into a racecourse and an amusement park. What a waste, said Marshall Stevens, because he knew that if on the Trafford's land could be built wharves and warehouses, factories and tank farms, the ship canal would make a profit for the citizens of Manchester and for himself a fortunate future as director of Trafford Park Estates.
Trafford Park Estates are enormously proud of their achievement because they've built it all without any government help, no carrot and sticking from Whitehall, without any subsidy at all. In their booklet, they say what they've done is that the woods, the farms and the 8-acre lake have gone. The deer, the pheasants and the rabbits are just a memory. They say the verdant, velvet-like turf has given way to concrete floors for big factories. With the transformation of a feudal estate into a hive of industry, Manchester lost a lung but picked up a sinew.
Yes.
Your garden is the last piece of park true. Left in Trafford Park.
Absolutely true. Absolutely true. And it's a lovely little place, too. It is really the last part of the old beautiful park that belonged to the old Trafford family. This was a very beautiful park in the 1890s, up to the turn of the century. And I suppose, really, it is true to say this is the last part of it. The whole of it was part of the estate of the old Trafford family. very old Catholic family, and about the time that I'm talking about, the turn of the century, they were very, very generous to the Catholic body in this area.
Are the big
and they've
firms
left a great name for themselves.
Are the big firms generous?
In a certain way, they are.
The new lords and masters?
Not in the same way, no, as the old Catholic family, no. No, they're not. When people go around begging to the firms, they sometimes give them arms, you know, for charitable purposes. But they don't endow churches like the old Trafford family used to.
This is AEI, the heart of the park. Metropolitan Vicars, the first and biggest still. £250,000 of steel and skill in that turbine for a power station in Hartlepool or Madras. This great cathedral of a works opened in 1902 by the American Westinghouse with Manhattan cocktails in the aisles, the same today as then. They build to last, machines to light up the world. This is the place that grew Hugh Scanlon. In the war, they worked 4 days and nights without clocking off on radar and radio, Beatles and bombers and mobile transformers for Soviet Russia. Everything then. Today, it's been taken over by GEC Power Engineering, thinned out and rationalised. Today, they make only the elephants of heavy electrical engineering. But they've made so many men redundant, they're setting on again. And for those left, it's full overtime, 20 hours a day for 7 days a week. And of the 7,000 human factors who work here, a small percentage live across the road, like Walter Pye, who's just relieved as a welder, Dave Wilson. Dave Wilson now has left the works. And home for bed and breakfast in an island of dwelling houses opposite the works, built on the American gridiron pattern from 1st Street, 2nd Street, 3rd Street, 4th Street, all the way to 12th Street. A village, a community. This also is Trafford Park.
I didn't even know there was any houses in Trafford Park until I came here. And to the outsider, people who don't know I live in Trafford Park and suddenly find out, they can't understand why you're living in Trafford Park. What do you want to live around here for? You know, all the pollution, etc. You know. I wasn't born in the park. There's people that's born in the park, you know, it's their home, you know. Well, they don't know of any other place, like, you know, it's a home, you know, like a village. People stay in the village, you know, they get married and they go into fine houses in the village. Well, they do that here, it's exactly the same.
Your drinks. I drink them up, they're good girls. Yeah, Paula.
All right. I work all, any overtime is going, I work. And the prospects, what I've been told for the next 6 years is very good. That we'll be doing this full overtime, etc., you know. I like to enjoy going there. It might sound strange, you know, but it does. I don't mind getting up in the morning and going to work. Like when I was at Kellogg's, I used to dread getting up.
Mrs. Meckle?
Yes?
What are you doing? Where are you going?
I'm going to work. But the way I go, there's no, no buses, you see, and it's a 20-minute walk. So Jean takes me to work in the car, and then she goes on to work after.
And what do you do for work?
I work at a plastic firm called Barber & Coleman, and they make lipstick cases and blocks for qualcast mowers and cooking hobs. They do the pressing of them and the printing of them and the packing.
What are they doing here?
They've dug all the train lines up, haven't they? And they're planting trees. They're making it look nice when people come in the park. which will look nice when the trees are grown. Mind you, I don't know when they will be grown. They're only small ones, aren't they?
What could be done with the houses?
Well, they could give them grants to have inside toilets. That's the only thing that's wrong with these houses. There's no inside toilets. And I think they should give us a grant. But you see, with it being in between, they don't know whether they're coming down or whether they're stopping up. We're in limbo, aren't we? We don't know where we're up to. So we don't feel like paying a lot of money out to have them done up.
Changing again, the houses in the park are. Is it inevitable, this change?
Oh, I think so. Oh, yes. These houses now have been up quite a long time. I'm not very happy at the breakup of a very pleasant and happy community. People with whom I've been very, very happy to work. I suppose I can say, as a priest here, my job mainly has been to provide the Mass and the sacraments for the people. As you know, along with that goes a good deal of education work. But all the same, I'm very, very conscious of the fact that this community here had been under great stress and strain for many years past, and it's inevitable that with all the movement of population, that the local authority should think of moving them out to better housing, more salubrious atmosphere. I think this is inevitable, yes.
Well, I wouldn't knock the park if I was you, because I like the park. It's been very good to me. Now, it has everything as anybody could ask for. It's only a little place. It's got two churches, two schools for the infants. The big children go on a bus to school. Now, it's got a lovely swimming bath there. We've got a washhouse, as anybody can use. And it's very, very cheap, better than all the laundrettes. And it's got as many shops as anybody else. We've got two chip shops, two butchers, public house, we've got workers, we've got Legion, British Legion, and anybody who wants entertainment other than that, it doesn't take them long to go on the bus and get out. Otherwise, I like the park and it's been very, very good to me and my children. They've all done well. I'm very pleased I came to the park in the first place. So I don't want anybody to knock it because it's done me great.
Excuse me, what are you doing?
I'm opening the church. Oh.
But most of the people have gone to work already, to the factories.
Oh yes, I know, but there's still a lot of people live in the park, pass this way to school and that, and there are a lot of people coming off night work who slip into the church.
What do they slip into the church for?
Well, just to have a quiet few minutes with the thoughts and the problems. No better place. You see, in the country, they call it Rogation Sunday, don't they? And they bring in the seeds and the flour and that kind of thing. Well, we've nothing like that in this area, so we bring in, or we did do, what this area produces and what we hope to grow in this area, you see, which is the nuts and the bolts and the oil from the raft and the dyes and that from the chemical works and steel, all kinds of things like that.
This place was glovers. They made cable, wire, submarine that lay on the bottom of oceans so people in Liverpool could talk to New York, people in Stretford to Battle Creek, Michigan. But then man sent a rocket into the sky with a tiny Telstar on it and glovers were finished. Modern technology means doing more with less. The tiny transistor, the Telstar, replacing the cumbersome cable.
The job's been going now 200 years. Now it's coming to a close. If the government had subsided them, canals should have done years ago. This country wouldn't have been in a state with these motorways and what have you. These canals, they're going to put money in. They're going to put money in and put the barges on a licence instead of paying tolls. They could have competed with motor wagons. They would have done it easy. But you see, motor wagons just pay a licence. We pay about £2 a ton a mile. All that kind of business. Nothing new. They'll have to open canals up before long to get the stuff about country.
Their work's future is at the mercy of great and distant forces of government and international capitalism, as mysterious as the corn they carry first grew on a Red Indian, Hiawatha's grave.
He must have created some of them, he must. The only Indian they ever buried, didn't he? He was going to feed the Indian nation. There's your stand of your corn. As far as we're concerned, there's your stand of it for us. No, I know that, I am nothing.
Oh, him, he was in long work, Longfellow's poem, him, you know. Aye. Besides that, like, I mean, a lot of this corn, he was first originated, and so they tell us, by this Dr. Kellogg to feed his... Well, in first instance, he was a sick man, his wife made it to feed him, and he had an asylum, like. He fed the rest of them off it. He's not done bad ever since, has he? I mean, he's been good. He died a few years ago, about 90-odd years of age. From all I can see, he must keep eating Kellogg's every day, doesn't he?
What we'll have to do, we don't know. This is last at barges. No more barges left.
The age of rationalisation for corn as it was for AI. Cheaper to do their foundry work in Sheffield and Germany. And to take a proud tradition down, a lady destruction worker boss.
I think one's got to go round AEI to see what it's been. It's been so many different things at so many different times, you know. I feel privileged in a way to be getting rid of a building that has got no way as I see it anyway, of being converted, you know, next door. Because it's been thinned now, because the buildings have been thinned now, you know, you're able to use that building. There's so many buildings, both, I should think, in AEI and also throughout Trafford Park, also in the rest of Trafford Park, which can't be refurbished, you know, which will have to come down. You know, if they'd have been usable buildings, I would have thought that more would have been used in the past, you know, but instead we've just got buildings lying idle, lying wasted, you know, due to the fact they were custom built.
If I was an industrialist, what would you say to me to attract me to bring a factory into Trafford Park?
Well, I'd say that the advantages of coming into Trafford Park would be the motorways, being able to go in all directions. I'd say the people. That the people that Trafford Park drew, just you know, they didn't come from just Stretford, they came from quite a considerable distance, you know. And the people in the north are about the best people in the world, you know. They'll work. You know, they want to work. It proved it in the past when there were so many people working in the park then. If the figures have gone down, you know, it's because the work's not there. I feel quite sure that, you know, when the manufacturers come in, there'll be plenty of people to work in them, not like in some of the new towns, you know. Sometimes there, you know, they built the factories and didn't have the people. The majority of cases, they built the houses, put the people in, then had to attract people into empty houses, then had to build factories to take the people to work. Here, we've got the houses, we've got the people.
What are you doing, Mr. Gallows?
I'm getting the beer ready for the opening up, whereby we'll be absolutely murdered within the next 10 minutes, quarter of an hour. And we'll have that many coming in that they haven't the time to drink the beer as they require in such a short time, so we've got to get the beer ready for them.
Why haven't they got the time?
Well, since they wanted shorter hours, they've cut the dinner hours down so they can finish earlier in the evening.
Ah.
So instead of having an hour's dinner now, they've gone to half an hour's dinner. And they still want the same capacity of drinking as they normally did.
Morning, Jean.
Morning, Jean.
20 minutes late.
Have you been working this morning?
Yeah. just got back now. Just calling for my dinner. I've been to Huddersfield. Have you ever had your Huddersfield?
Why is there... why is everybody apart from you look so glum, Michael?
Well, they've only got half an hour for dinner and I've got an extension.
In the war and the 1950s, twice as many men packed Trafford Park. Those who knew can never forget. It isn't what it was.
I've seen the time of one of my men have been carried down the down Third Avenue. They were just one solid mass. The outlet of a football match was no comparison.
Explain something to me, John, that I find puzzling to me. Why should I think your job is happier than, say, working on the shop floor in AEI?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a way of life to us, like we're used to the job, you know. Been at it ever since, well, near enough ever since I left school, bar for being in the army. And I say it's easy come, easy goes type of thing. I mean, a lot of the old boatmen don't like to say it, like, you know, but it, mostly descended from the gypsies, you know, one thing or another. I mean, that's part of this job. The buying and selling of things, you know. I mean, years ago, you used to buy and sell your own horses.
Yeah.
You know, buy. I mean, this type of work being in Manchester is one thing. Now, say, going to Liverpool. It's a funny thing. I mean, ask a dirt track rider why he goes round. Bit of a thrill. Honestly, these things jump out of water. Same thing. Stem's coming up. Ah. And you'll find it this way, in a lot of industries, where a man isn't tied to the clock, you never find him late. You'll always find him there early, more often than not. I did a little bit of shore. And the first instance, it was nice. Now, you go and you start clocking on. And eventually, when you ring that bell, it's like somebody's banged up a guy in Dorby, aren't you?
They don't ring no bell, no factory hooter at Kellogg's. Just be there, stripped and changed before you clock, ready to go on time. The work isn't hard. All you have to do is be there. Just watch. This factory hand watches for flakes that may have been accidentally over-toasted, watches that vitamins don't overflood the bereaved cornflakes.
Do you think God thinks it's better for someone to work on a lathe as a skilled operator at AEI rather than pressing buttons making cornflakes?
Oh, I suppose the salary might settle that one. I don't think it's such a silly question. I think both jobs are important. And if a man puts his heart and soul into one or the other, I think he's probably fulfilling himself.
But are not some jobs more dignified than others?
I suppose this is true. Yes, those jobs which are just automation, I suppose it must be very difficult to fulfill yourself doing a job like that. But nevertheless, it's important, I suppose, in the whole wheel of industry. It's a part, isn't it? If you are not doing it, somebody else is going to miss the work that you're doing.
But doesn't God look on some with more favour than others?
Oh, I hope not. No. I think the sunshine and grace of Almighty God shines on all equally. No matter what post they're in.
Kellogg's have convinced me that their new mill will open in Liverpool and that for them it's going to be cheaper to do away with the bargees and to bring their half-done corn in six road tankers into Trafford Park from Liverpool. But it seems sad that something pleasant and good like the bargees and the canal system is done away with. We just don't seem to be clever enough, determined enough, to find other ways of organising work. There's not a single factory in Trafford Park I know that doesn't exist except by the strictest cost accountants' rules. We are so stupid.
Right, will you take the floor for the squash, please?
Hey, girl, what you doing down there? Dancing alone every night while I live right above you. I can hear your music playing. I can feel your body swaying. One floor below me, you don't even know me. I love you. Oh, my darling, not three times on the ceiling if you want me.
The houses are good solid houses, the majority of them, Accrington stock bricks on the front, you know. Some of them are little palaces. And they had much nicer spirit round there than on your vast new estates.
How does it show itself? This much nicer spirit?
Well, I don't suppose it's as much keeping up with the Joneses, you know, everybody seems to help everybody else, which they appear to lose in the rat race once they go on the new estates. You know, everybody's after a new telly and a new carpet. And, you know, they're so busy looking after themselves that they forget about the neighbour, you know. It doesn't seem to happen in Trafford Park.
Hey, Mike.
Hello, Frank. All right.
Apart from having no proper lavatory, it's a nice house, isn't it, that you've got?
How do you mean, proper lavatory?
Well, it's out the back, isn't it?
Well, it's still a proper toilet, isn't it?
Yeah. Why don't you move? Because you must earn enough money.
Well, I like it here. It's cheap living, you know, Trafford Park. You can afford things what other people can't. But we're paying £4.09 a month.
A month?
A month. To buy the house.
But you're surrounded by all these factories, all this...
Yeah, well, it's handy. People come here to work, don't they? My work's here. I come out of the house into the motor straight to work. Never have a day off. My wife goes to work. It's good. It's good living. If I want a pint at night, the Legion's there. Or the Working Men's Club, that's a good club.
Is that all there is to life?
Well, what are you looking for? Exactly.
If you look out your window tonight, pulling the string with the note that's attached to my heart.
For Mrs. Langer, she knows what she's looking for. She comes from a waltzing Vienna, and through misfortune, now she's dumped in her old age as a newcomer in a twilight Trafford Park.
Oh, my darling, not three times on the ceiling if you want me.
For me, it looks like a prison. Wherever you go, there's waltz and waltz.
But the people are very friendly, Mrs.
Yes. Very friendly?
Yes.
Are you joking? You must really joking, you think the people are friendly. They're nosy, but not friendly. That's my opinion about them. Peeping behind the curtain, they know when people going out was coming back. They know everybody's business. I know people's business was I've never seen.
But that makes a community life, doesn't it?
There's community life in Trafford Park. Where's the community life? There's nowhere to go.
But there's clubs for the old people.
Yes. It's not everybody's pleasure to go there. You should break this all up. You shouldn't bring fresh people in. I know the next street old lady with nearly 80 they brought her in the park. They have not the right playing about with human beings like this. For me, this is not a fit place to live for a human being.
Have you ever talked about any of this to any of the politicians?
No, I haven't. I never get the chance. Nobody comes and asks me.
But they come here every week.
Where?
To the church.
Which church?
The church on Third Avenue.
Every week?
Every week.
It's only since...
I'll take you.
It's only since last month it started. First week in...
But have you been?
Yes.
To see them?
Yes, I've seen one of the councillors. Yes. You see, they can nothing do about the house. They can nothing do.
Good evening, love. Can you sit down?
Thank you.
What can I do for you? What's your problem?
Are you dealing with the town hall?
Oh, yes.
The council problems.
26 years I've been. Yeah.
I am a council tenant.
Yeah.
In Second Street.
In Second Street.
They've got mice.
Yeah.
Something I don't like with the children. You know, I mean, they're walking in the babies, cotton the babies, pram, it's not on, you know. The babies.
Why on earth didn't you contact me or one of the other councillors before
seen Ray
now?
Babaclough.
How long ago did you see
last
Ray?
Last week. He was in the park.
But unfortunately, he's gone in hospital. I don't know whether you know.
No, I didn't
That's probably the answer to that, unfortunately.
They're in there, Mrs. Langer. In you go. Every Thursday evening, particularly at election times, the councillors from Stretford, who control Trafford Park, come down here to the church and hold a little surgery where they listen to people's troubles. Mrs. Langer's gone in to see the leader, the leading politician of Trafford Park, Alderman Armitage.
Well, the majority of them have been cleared, and those guards, you know, the backyards... Where people
Mr. Armitage was my one I see. Neither
yeah.
you nor anybody else will tell me a tale. No. I have watched the houses breaking up. I always make sure before I open my mouth and have a big one. If I'm open, it's only this big mouth. When I see it, mit my own ear saying, the houses are all bricked up, mit all the fields and dirt in. Yeah. And the corporation gives me a house. My beetles like this. Yeah. That is not a lie. It was stinking, this place. They have no right for sending human beings in houses like this.
Couldn't agree with you more. We're trying to get them out. That's the point. That's the object of the scheme, to brick them up and get people out of them.
The local council for 4 years has been unable to make its mind up whether Trafford Park should be demolished or should be improved. People who live here can't get improvement grants, they can't get mortgages, and when the council get hold of the odd house here and there, they brick it up like an omen of a doom to come. Winston Churchill, the local MP, says no one should live in Trafford Park, in the middle of all the industry, but people have done, and they still do, and they thrive. The community's got a lot going for it, paradoxically, because of all the workers who pour in to shop at the local shops and to support things like the British Legion.
They come from all over. They've gone out of the park, but they still come back. I don't know why, but they like the atmosphere. Even though they've left Trafford Park and gone into Stretford and these new areas. I have people come down from Altrincham, Partington, Timperley. They all come down. They've left the park. They've worked in the park. They've lived in the park. But they still come down here, even for the evening's activities. It's a village in a village to me. That's the way I look at it.
Well, there we are, ladies and gentlemen. Another winner, and Mrs. Pauline Watson. Pauline, would you please stand up, darling? One of our former pageant queens from bygone days. However, she still looks beautiful.
What were the street pageants like, Mrs. Mackle?
There was a lovely day and everybody joined in, didn't they? Everybody helped as much as they could. And all the children really enjoyed it because they used to get crisps and buns on the day. And all the children wanted to be on the lorries. We used to have two queens and a rosebud princess win. Pageant queen and a beauty queen. And all the retinue, and then we had tableaus. And all the firms round here used to be very good, and they used to lend us the lorries to put the tableaus on.
Where can you walk here about? Voy, 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 prison.
Because they're putting trees up in the
there for the dogs. For the dogs. They're putting trees for the dogs. It's only improve the houses. The houses need to improve, not the trees. The trees are only good for the dogs, but there's more dogs than people in the park.
I remember Trafford Hall. Yes, I lived in Trafford Hall.
Lived there?
Yes. Till the war broke out, and then we had to move out. We were given 48 hours to get out, because the troops arrived at midnight.
Was it nice, the hall?
Oh, very nice, yes. Lovely gardens. My father kept the gardens.
And now this garden?
Yes.
What sort of birds in the garden?
Robins. Blackbirds. A white sparrow.
A what?
A white sparrow. 2 years ago, we had a white sparrow. And there was an owl. Earlier on in this year, there was an owl in the trees. And the blackbirds, of course. And there's been blue tits and yellow ones. They come every year. But I've not seen the white sparrow come back again.
From certain firms, you know, there's a very unpleasant smell wafts over this dwelling area, which is very unpleasant. I know when I first came here, some friend told me not to worry about my health, because no self-respecting germ would live in Trafford Park.
They're modernising the bathroom. They're moving people out of the town and out of the houses in Stretford, isn't this correct?
Yes.
Because I work with you.
Yes.
They're putting them into other council houses while their own homes get modernised. As I've just said, with central heating, and what do we get done?
Nothing. Well, this is very simple. This is a very simple thing. This. What is happening, of course, is the council using money from the sale of land to make council homes better for the people that are living in them. Now, they've no control over the houses in Trafford Park because they don't own them.
Listen,
they've been in there.
If you go about anything in the park, they don't care. If you live in Stretford or anywhere else, you get anything done. But if you go to the town hall, you say you're from Trafford Park, no chance. Nothing at all. They don't want to know you.
But the main thing is this. It's the cheapness. You can afford to live comfortably. Without no worries where your next meal's coming from, as I say, I'm going to Spain on a picnic next week. Later on in the year, I'm going fishing to Scotland. And I can afford this quite comfortable. I must admit, of course, my wife's working. And I have a good job, you know.
A census should be taken, officially. And let those people decide whether or not they want to live in the park or whether they don't want to live in the park. At the time when they were built, probably all those people who moved into those houses wanted to live in those houses because they worked in the park. Now, probably times have changed. Probably a lot of people who don't work in the park live in the houses. People did say to me at that time, you know, that they'd like to do away with them. You know, they didn't like being in the park because of the smoke. They didn't like being in the park because of the industry. But of course, you know, it is an industrial estate.
All this at the Barton Dock end of Trafford Park is a planner's dream, a sketch of what an artist thinks the future ought to be like. Here there is total motorway access and ingress, roads 10 times wider than the Bridgewater Canal, and no awkward little community of houses stuck in the middle. No church, no shops, nothing like that at all. No people. No company this end of Trafford Park is going to be obliged, as Metro Vicars were, to aid the neighbourhood, because there isn't a neighbourhood. No company here will be asked to provide a float for the pageant in the streets across the road, because there aren't any streets across the road. Total segregation between factories and houses. No intimacy, as in the village of Trafford Park, where people work, where they live.
It's like a bloody Norman invasion, isn't it? Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, this time, please, would you please do me the honour and stand for the Queen? Thank you.